born in San Antonio, Texas. I don't really want to talk too much about myself. I don't want to do that, but I do want to talk about a couple of things. First of all, my family. The Valdez family of San Antonio, Texas. Plinio and Teresa Valdez had 8 children altogether. The oldest son, Henry Valdez, was drafted during Korea. The youngest son, Ramiro Valdez, was drafted during Vietnam. There was 2 draftees in our family, 2 people who served their country. One of us came back, a highly decorated veteran with a Bronze Star and a Purple Heart and all kinds of awards. The other one of us just came back, and that was me, and I'm okay with that. My brother's a hero. I want to make sure that the whole world knows I'm not a hero. I got drafted. I didn't want to go. I didn't really care for the Army, but in some ways they didn't really care for me. No, I'm kidding. They did. I did well in the Army. I've prided myself most of my life that I did 2 things well in my entire life. One of them was I was a good soldier. The other one is I believe I was a good father. Everything else is a little questionable, but those 2 I'm very proud of. My family, I'm very proud of. Henry is now 87 years old. He's in a nursing home, and he was a Korean veteran. And then there was me. There was 2 of us. We were drafted from the farm where we were migrant workers. I will never forget the night when they had to come looking for us to tell us that my brother had been shot in Korea. They had to find us way, way out in the middle of nowhere on a small farm, and the Red Cross came out looking for us. They brought the owner of the farm because he could speak some Spanish, and the Red Cross people couldn't speak Spanish, and they came to tell us that my brother had been shot, and my mother was of course very upset. And I remember the man and the woman from the Red Cross looking at the farmer and saying, "Tell him this, tell him that." We didn't know what they were saying. But that was, we were migrant workers. My mother never had any education. She didn't even complete the first grade. My father had 3 years of education. And that was it. Back then, women weren't valued very much. And so it didn't matter whether a woman went to school or not. My father was this short little Mexican guy, and it didn't matter if he went to school or not. So they had no education, but my mother did an outstanding job of raising her children. When I got drafted, I had just finished college. I had a degree in English, fresh in my hot hands. I got a job as an assistant editor for a magazine in Kansas City. So I went up to Kansas City, and in a short, about a 4 or 5 month period, I had 6 poems published. I'm sorry, 6 articles published, 4 poems. Then I got drafted, and I went into the service, and when I came out, I never went back to writing. And sometimes, late at night, I wonder whatever became of that young man that was so happy in Kansas City, writing and publishing. Well, about 30 or 40 years later, I got back to writing, and I'm trying to write now. Thank the Lord for that. I'm trying to write. Audie Murphy movies and all of these kinds of things. We grew up watching World War II movies. So we were in a way desensitized to people dying or people getting killed. I think that was a big factor in Vietnam. because Vietnam was an effrontery in many ways. It was a confrontation of reality. When you grow up seeing people get killed and then they're okay after that, you sort of become desensitized. But there's nothing in the world that will bring you to reality like seeing a man's face blown away. A face just blown away. It brings you into reality, and it makes you aware what reality's about. I think that has to be a factor in the Vietnam War, the first ever war in the history of our country and probably the world that was fought by the products of television and people who were sort of insensitive to reality. The second way that Vietnam was different is that Vietnam did not really produce any heroes. World War I produced Alvin York, a highly decorated soldier. World War II produced Audie Murphy. God, World War II gave us Eisenhower, MacArthur, Patton, and Audie Murphy. And even after Vietnam, the Iraqi War gave us Colin Powell. We've had every war almost has consistently produced a big hero that everybody looked up to. We didn't have that in Vietnam. We didn't have a hero. Recently, Senator McCain or Secretary of State John Kerry have been given some recognition for their service, but it wasn't part of the reason that they became senators. They didn't brag about it at first. It was only recently that they have been recognized because we produced no heroes. The most decorated man in Vietnam, nobody's ever heard of, Joseph Hooper. Joseph Hooper got more medals than Audie Murphy or Alvin York. He was highly decorated. No one recognized him. No one gave him any credit. As a matter of fact, he himself said they hated the war, or they didn't like the war. Why in the world would they like me? And he died alone and broken down alcoholic. He was from the Yakima Valley in Washington, and he never really got any recognition for being the big hero like other heroes were given recognition. Instead of producing a hero, Vietnam knows the name Lieutenant Calley, Captain Medina, and over 300 people that were massacred in My Lai. That's what we remember, or what a lot of people remember from Vietnam. It wasn't the hero, it was the anti-hero. It wasn't a glorious thing. We didn't liberate any concentration camps. We didn't march victoriously into any villages. We didn't get hugs and kisses from anyone. We never got one single damn yellow ribbon. Nobody patted us on the back. Nobody told us, you're doing a good job. Instead, we got the opposite. I personally was called a baby killer. I know that we were instructed not to go off base in our uniform, and we didn't. If you walked into a bar anywhere in the United States, anywhere in this country, in your uniform, you were asking for a fight, and you knew it. So you didn't go in uniform anywhere, not to the grocery store, not to church, not to the mall, anywhere. You did not wear your uniform, and a lot of the guys had wigs. We bought wigs because long hair and beards were in style back then. And everybody had long hair except soldiers. So the guys bought wigs and they could pass that they were civilians. If you walked around with short hair, they knew you were a soldier and didn't like you. They didn't like Vietnam. That was the way that Vietnam was different. We did not have That's the third way that it was different. We did not have the support of the populace. Every war that our country has ever been involved in has had people backing them up. People are proud of our men in uniform. People want to support our troops. They didn't during Vietnam. Not only did they not support us, they pretty much did not like us. They didn't like the men in uniform. Mao Zedong said, "Politics is war without bloodshed. War is politics with bloodshed." And that's what we found. The whole damn thing in Vietnam was political. It was all politics. We never bombed Hanoi. We didn't cross a certain area. There was only certain things you could do. What were we trying to accomplish in Vietnam? Kill the gooks. That's it. Take a country, take a land, take a hill, take a city. No, none of that. It was a political war, highly, highly politicized. As a result of that, the American public didn't like it. Unfortunately, as a result of that, they didn't like the soldiers. I remember in April the 30th of 1975, when Saigon fell, they had a parade in San Francisco. They had people walking up and down the streets cheering and celebrating the fall of Saigon. And what the hell? I mean, what did that say to the American soldier? What did that say to the guys that fought in Vietnam? That we didn't have the support of the populace. That's how Vietnam was different. It was different that those three ways, we didn't have the support. And probably a footnote that has to be added is that Vietnam was the first war where there was a massive, huge problem with drugs. There wasn't as much drug use in World War II or World War I. Of course, World War II, the Nazis invented methadone to use with soldiers, but they weren't using it just for recreational purposes. In Vietnam, drugs became a big factor. And I think that was part of our having to face the reality that we were facing, that the soldiers were facing at that time. So there was also the problem of drug abuse in Vietnam. After all of these guys got out, they then began to deal with the war wounds. The wounds of Vietnam were not so much physical as they were emotional, mental, spiritual. Because I think there was a certain loss, a certain emotional disconnect with serving your damn country, and your damn country is ashamed of you, or your country doesn't like you. Oh, I know, I've heard a lot of people tell me, "Oh, I support the troops. I always supported the troops. I've always been. Well, all I have to say about that is there must have been one guy then that went all over the damn country calling the soldiers names, because everybody else seems to be in support now. Well, the truth of the matter is that people forget. They didn't like us, and we felt it. That has been, I think, the problem that the whole Vietnam era soldiers had to deal with, is the emotional wounds. The wound at serving your country and being dishonored by your own country. That was the emotional wound. And I think Vietnam has had more psychiatric problems than any other war. And it's not because these guys are crazy. It's because of that recognition that, I mean, When I came home for Christmas, my parents wanted me to take my uniform off so we could go see family. They didn't want me to wear it. When I ETS'd, when I got out, my mother gave my uniform away. Well, she gave it to the Goodwill. Hopefully somebody wore it. It wasn't that we did a poor job in Vietnam. It's that the soldiers were not appreciated. But it's getting better. I don't want to end on a sour note. I want to say that it's getting better. I was at a medical conference a few years ago, like in 2006 or so, about 10 years ago, where there was the director of the VA for that region did a presentation. And as he stood there in front of these 100 people or so, he said, we have been given an order from on high that we're not going to treat the Iraqi veterans the way we treated the Vietnam veterans. And I almost jumped up and hugged him. I was so glad to hear, that. First of all, I was glad to hear somebody finally admitted the VA treated the Vietnam vets like crap for decades, like crap. And secondly, I was glad to hear that the next generation of soldiers are not going to have to put up with that stuff. The next generation of soldiers are going to be treated better. But I think it's gotten better in this regard. The VA is now working with the Vietnam veterans. The VA gave me these things. Without them, I am about 80-90% deaf. Came from a grenade exploding outside my foxhole. Too close, and it blew out my ears. With them, I can hear. And the VA gave them to me. They're very expensive, and I got them for free. I think that's a good sign. I think the good thing is that the VA is coming around, and the VA is being helpful to us. The other way that it's good is I think that it's changing, that it's getting better, is that people are being positive to the Vietnam vets. I've had some people tell me that, and it's a wonderful gesture. It is. It's a wonderful gesture, and I deeply appreciate it, but it embarrasses me. I always just look down and say, I'm not a hero, I got drafted. Part of it is the wound of Vietnam, the emotional wound. What the hell were we doing there? Why were we there? I mean, Vietnam had an election, a democratic election. They elected Ho Chi Minh, the president. He was a communist. So we wanted to overthrow the communist government. I've always said it's like if the state of Alabama decided to secede from the Union. They did not like the person that got elected president, and they went to war against the rest of the country. And then Canada jumped in and helped Alabama fight the rest of the country. That's what it was like. Because it was a civil war. It's among themselves. And we jumped in, started out as advisors back in 65, advising. And then we got involved more and more and more. And it just got to be politicized completely. But as I was saying, the good thing is that people are saying thank you. It took a while to get the Vietnam Memorial up, but it went up. That's good. And now I've seen Vietnam memorials in many parts of the country, specifically mentioning Vietnam. And I think that's wonderful. I think that's great. Because in a lot of ways, the Vietnam soldiers just waited and waited for decades for this to come around. There's a Vietnam memorial at the Midland Odessa Airport. that I love. I've been there several times. It's a statue of three Vietnam era soldiers. Obviously, I recognize the uniform. I recognize the black boots, the M16, the grenade launcher, the M60 automatic with a hot barrel. And they're carrying a wounded guy. And they're looking off in the distance, and there's a helicopter. There's a huge helicopter there that they put up on a pedestal. And the helicopter, it's as if the helicopter's coming down for a dust-off. And these three guys are moving that way, and they're looking to the helicopter. And I think the beauty of that memorial is that those soldiers are still waiting. They're standing there waiting for that chopper to come down and get them. And the same thing in the movie Platoon, where that one guy was left behind and he was reaching up to the helicopter and he was waiting. I think for many, many years, the Vietnam veterans have been waiting for a dust off, waiting for a rescue. Yes, we're in a hot LZ. Yes, the chopper can't land, but still waiting for the rescue. And I think it looks like it's finally coming. Looks like it's coming in this century, the 21st century. In the past 5 or 10 years, things have begun to change. Thank God for that. Things have begun to change so that Vietnam veterans can begin to openly connect. Openly do something about it. And especially I want to address the Vietnam veterans who may take a moment and look at this. The wounds can heal. My friend Ron Hyden got psychiatric help. And he's okay now. He's married now. This one's lasting. He's okay now. He got help. I think it's important that the Vietnam vets recognize that John Wayne is dead and Sylvester Stallone himself would tell you that it takes a real man to ask for help. I think the emotional wound can be healed if the guy reaches out for help. I think that's what's important, to reach out for help and get some help. My other buddy, Dave Wilson, killed himself fighting the VA, trying to get benefits, and they gave him the runaround, like they did me, like they did most of us. And I went out to San Angelo and I went to the place where he shot himself, and I stood there and I heard for him. Wilson was gone. And I heard for him, and I wished that he had gotten help, that he had reached out, like they're telling the soldiers nowadays, to reach out and get help. I think this help is available because the VA is now changing. And to go back full circle to my mama and papa and our time and how proud they were. But I do want to do one thing. When I was in, there was a bunch of Hispanics that got into. You know, we would hang out together. And you know, when you're in basic training and you're marching, they make you sing. It maintains the breath, the breathing, so that you march left, 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 right, left, and then you sing. Around her hair she wore a yellow ribbon, left, 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 right, left, and then the sergeant sings it and then the company repeats it. Well, we did that with this group of Hispanics, and we did it in Spanish. And that's unique, and that's something that I thought I would want to share. It happened during Vietnam. It started at Lanier High School in San Antonio, Texas, and then went on into the Army. And here's what we did. Here's what we did. Are you ready? Okay, left, 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 right, left. Aquí andamos marchando. Left, left, dándole gusto a la raza. Left, left, pues todos somos chicanos. Left, left, ya los frijoles les entramos. Left, right, left, a mí me gustan las güeras. Left, 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 right, left, como a cualquier mexicano. También las morenas y prietas, pues a todas les entramos. Okay, that's kind of rated R, but that was just an army song. This group of Hispanic soldiers got together and marched, and we sang in Spanish. And when I rode home, I wrote in Spanish. You know, there's been several books have been put together of letters written home, Civil War veterans, World War I, World War II veterans, of the beautiful, heartfelt letters that they wrote home to their family, to their wives and mothers. Well, I wish I could start a collection, because there was a bunch of letters that were written home in Spanish. I wrote in Spanish to my mother. Estimado mi papá, la presente va para saludarles. Esperando que todo esté bien con ustedes, así como está conmigo. No quiero que se preocupen por mí. I would always tell them, no se preocupen. Don't worry about me. Like, I guess every other guy in the Army did. We wrote home in Spanish. I wrote home in Spanish. And I think that's significant. I think that's something that people need to be aware of, and that's why I'm grateful to Sylvia for doing this, that people need to know we're Americans, dude. We're Americans. We're not immigrants. We're not foreigners. We're Americans. When they drafted me, they didn't ask me, where was your father or your grandfather or your great-grandfather born? No. I don't think there's anything that can be more American than getting drafted. And I got drafted, and that makes me an American, and that makes a lot of other guys Americans. We're full-fledged Americans, first and last. And we wrote letters home in Spanish, because it is American. And I thank you, Sylvia, and I thank the Denton County for allowing us to do this. Yeah. The message to future generations, to the young, especially to the young Chicanitos, even if their parents are immigrants, even if they're illegal, and you were born here, then you're eligible. What I've said to young men when I was doing psychotherapy, I would tell young men, there's three times in your life when you need to fight, when you have to fight. The first time is if anybody is hurting your mother. If anybody hurts your mother, no matter who it is, even if it's your father or your brother or the neighbor or a policeman or anybody, if anybody hurts your mother, you need to get in there and kick ass, or get kicked. If anybody hurts your mother, don't ever stand aside and let somebody hurt your mother without you do something. That's the first time. The second time is, if there is somebody who is injuring one of your family or loved ones, injuring your family or loved ones, the thing to do is to try and get them out and into safety. For instance, if your brother's in a fight, try to stop the fight. But, you know, jump in and say, whoa, wait, let's stop the fight, stop, stop. But if somebody jumps you, or if you can't stop it, then it's time to fight. Somebody's hurting a loved one or a member of your family. Somebody breaks into your home. You get in there and you try to protect your family. Try to protect your loved ones. The first instance with your mother, you fight no matter what. You don't ask questions. You don't try to stop the fight. You don't try and get her off to safety, no. You get in there and you fight. Don't let anybody hurt your mother. Second one is your family. With your family, you can try to stop the fight. Try to be reasonable, if it's possible. Stop the fight. If you can't, then you fight. And the third time to fight is if your country goes to war. If your country calls you, then you put on a uniform, just like I did. And you go and you serve your country. And you serve your country honorably. And you do what your country expects of you. That's the only three times in your whole life that you absolutely must fight. Any other time, there's no reason for violence. There's no reason for fighting. We're human beings. We can talk to each other. We can communicate. We can work things out verbally to understand each other. It's better to work things out, except for those three times. And those three times in your life, then you gotta fight. That's what I advise. That's it.
I'm from Denton, Texas.
First generation, second generation, third generation?
I served in the United States Marine Corps, Operation Desert Shield, Desert Storm, and the Persian Gulf War. One of the greatest lessons I learned from the military is, one, to be a good leader, you have to be a good follower. And you have to learn from your leaders and what skills it takes to lead you yourself, and therefore you can take those to lead others. Another thing is just really a love for my country, a love for you know, your brothers and sisters in the service, and most importantly in the service, or in the Marines. For definitely, you know, there is no, everybody is, especially when it comes to boot camp, everybody's equal. You know, you're all the same. And to the Marines, you're just you're just different shades of green. Well, I served in the Gulf War. We were, we went into Kuwait and all the way into Kuwait City. And during that time, you know, you have a different perception of other countries and how they are. And once we got into Kuwait City, it looked just like downtown Fort Worth. And it really made me realize how similar we all are. And it made me realize how would I feel, or if something like that happened on our own are on our own turf, in our own environment. And so it really kind of put things in perspective. But it, while we were out there, what I thought most about was actually about right now, about my future. It really made me realize, I thought about my future. At the time, I wasn't married, wasn't in a relationship. So I really thought about that a lot, about what my future family would be, my future spouse. And I guess at that point, I really felt the calling for the vocation of marriage. You know, really, that's when it really resonated with me that I wanted to be married. I wanted to be a husband. I wanted to be a father. And so that was really one of the things that came out most for me being out there.
And so what was an aha moment that you had during your war?
You know, during that time, when you're in a combat situation, your faith changes quite a bit. That, you know, I was in college, you know, I was of college age, I was in my early 20s. So I had strayed away from my my upbringing, and like probably most young men do. But during that time, I really had a deeper sense of my faith, and several of my teammates were also grew up in faith in the Catholic Church. So we decided that, you know, while we're here, you know, we need to pray more. We need to, and so I wrote my parents to send me some rosaries for me and my teammates, so we could pray the rosary while we were there. And so usually it takes several weeks, you know, for the letter to get back to the United States and then to get that package back. Well, so I wrote the letter to my dad and asking him to send some rosaries. Well, 3 days later, I got a package, and it was a box full of rosaries and the little pamphlet of how to pray the rosary. So we were on the same page, or it was just divine intervention, which, you know, I think it was a little bit of both. And so many of us, we practiced and kind of relearned to pray the rosary. So that was just kind of an aha moment for me, because I really felt that that was God's way of enhancing our faith. So one of the things we did, we moved around to different positions a lot. Sometimes we'd be in a position for 5 minutes, sometimes for, you know, 15 hours, but we'd move around a lot. Because he sent me this box of rosaries, what we did, every position that we were in, we took a rosary and we buried it in the sand out there. So out there amongst our trail, we left some rosaries within the desert. You know, I think without a doubt, the military has enhanced who I am and has made me a better person. I probably could have easily gone down different paths, with the military, and especially the Marine Corps, with the esprit de corps, you know, having to be responsible for each other and your teammates, it just, you know, puts things in a whole different perspective, you know, where you have that accountability for each other. And so, you know, I carried that along in my non-military life, you know, that accountability to others and doing things for the greater good. You know, it's not just about ourselves, it's about the greater good. As a Hispanic, you know, really didn't experience the discrimination or anything like that that folks from years prior, and I'm very thankful, you know, for them paving that ground, and I think that's why, you know, but. You know, in any situation that you're at, you're an ambassador of what you are, what people perceive you to be. And so being in the military and being a Hispanic, you know, I felt like, you know, I'm an ambassador to I was ambassador to many things. You know, one, you know, my heritage. You know, a lot of people that you encounter in the military have never been around a Hispanic person, or even, you know, when we're overseas, you know. And so I'm an ambassador to that. You know, many people, you know, had never talked to a Texan before. You know, I was an ambassador for Texas, you know. You know, my faith, my Catholic faith, I was an ambassador to the Catholic Church. So everything that I do, I'm an ambassador to others. And so I've really felt that, you know, that hopefully those people, you know, had a positive experience with, you know, with getting to know me, you know. But the other thing, I think, and, you know, this certainly could be with any heritage, but I know from my heritage specifically, you know, my parents had a very strong work ethic. You know, my parents, you know, I'm first generation out of the field. You know, my parents picked cotton growing up and worked in the fields, and they always had that strong work ethic. And I think that's one thing that carried over, yeah, to me and through my military service. Yeah, I was able to take that work ethic and apply that, and in doing such, you know, there was, you know, certain honors and things like that I received, but it was based on that work ethic that I learned. Very good question. I would love for any of my children to join the military, and if that's what they choose to do, if they feel that calling for that. But I think as a father, and them seeing what I've done, and they have a greater sense of love for our country, and a pride, you know, for our country. And my kids know without a doubt that even today, if my service was called upon and my country needed me, that, you know, without a doubt, I would go. Of course, it'd be harder than it was back then, but, you know, that you know, I'd be willing to do that. And for future generations, I think it's the greatest gift that we can return to our country. We live in such a great country you know, we all have our faults. Every organization has its faults, but we are the greatest country in the world, and we're very blessed to be here. And that's one of the small things we can do to give back to our country is to do that for future generations. And you know, the military is not all about, you know, going to war. It's about, you know, protecting our state of being, protecting our roots, protecting our, you know, our heritage, our freedoms, and so I'd be honored for any of my kids to go, and wouldn't hesitate one bit if of course that's their calling.
I'm in the U.S. Army. I was infantry. I went in 1974 during the Vietnam era. I got sent to Germany for my first tour. After that, I came back to CONUS, to Fort Ord, for a year and a half. Went back to Germany for another 3 more years. Once I left Germany, came back to Fort Bliss again, and that's when I went to drill sergeant school in Fort Dix, New Jersey. Was a drill sergeant from 1981 to 1984. Once I completed my drill sergeant status, I went to the committee group, which the committee group is where you train the basic soldiers on how to survive in combat. From there, I went to Korea, where I stayed at a camp house, but I was attached to Camp Liberty Bell or platoon was attached to that unit over there at the DMZ. Once we finished in Korea, went back to Fort Bliss, where I finished off my career at Fort Bliss, 1992. The war never ended in Korea. The only thing they did a ceasefire up to this point. So anything that goes on in that area is just by keeping the patrolling the DMZ at all times, so make sure the enemy don't go across the border. But it's still very active. The only thing is only a ceasefire in the meantime. That's why it's so intensified in Korea, because you never know what might happen at any time. The reason I decided to join, this all started since I was a little kid, I guess. I was able to join the Boy Scouts, the Cub Scouts, when I was in elementary school. Then from there, I went to the Boy Scouts, and then from the Boy Scouts, I thought that I would like the military. So at age 17, I asked my mom to sign for me to go to the military. She finally decided to sign for me to leave the military, and then that's when I went to the military. It benefited me because I got disciplined a lot, because when I was a kid, I was too wild. And going into the military, that disciplines you very good. Being a Hispanic in the military, it's very different from any other you encounter, but don't forget that the military, any type of branch, you're gonna have black, whites, Indians, purple, green, blue, and you don't discriminate against each other because you're one team, and the person that's gonna be right next to you, he's the one that's gonna save your life during combat. So there's no issue of color in the military. And I think that the Hispanics are an advantage to the military in some cases, because a lot of the times some of the missions we used to do, we used to speak Spanish on the radio, and they didn't even know what we're saying throughout the platoon, so it was an advantage. The platoon didn't have nobody who spoke Spanish or understood Spanish, so we got away with a lot of stuff. When I first in, I wasn't married. I didn't get married till I was 23 years old, and I had my little boy. And being in drill sergeant status, you spend 12, 16 hours per day being a drill sergeant. I used to go in at 3 in the morning and don't get home till about 9 o'clock at night. That was 7 days a week. Sometimes the only time you get off is when you had duties to watch the company for that night. You were off the next day or during the cycles, because the battalion that I was at was the basic trainings go for 8 weeks, and we ship them out because we were just strictly basic training outfit. And then during that course, being a drill sergeant, it causes a lot of problems with the family and everything. So I got divorced after my second year of being a drill sergeant, and haven't been married ever since. As a father, I can't really say that, because when I got divorced, my kids were still very young. It was hard to communicate with them because they moved to California, and they've been in California all their life. So you still maintain contact and stuff like that. You try to guide them in the right way and make sure that they're okay at all times. I'm blessed that my two kids came out real good. My son has two boys, and my daughter has one girl. And a boy is coming up, and she'll be born in September the 27th of this year. No, none of my kids went to the military. They're all, they decided to pursue their studies in college. Well, I came to Denton in October. It'll be 10 years that I'm relocated to Denton. But when I got out in 1992, I just stayed in Fort Bliss, because that's what I retired of. And then from there, I just started working in dealerships. Also, I managed to have 2 nightclubs and a restaurant. And then I decided to leave the club business because it was nothing but being a vampire all night long. And when I relocated to Denton, I started working at the dealerships here. But now, since I'm retired, I decided just to go ahead and relax and help out veterans right now, as that I do for veterans, for doing claims for the veterans right now. Well, I would say to, like I said before, I tell everybody that you should go into the military no matter what. If you're wild, if you want to get a free education once you're in the military, you get discipline at the same time. And also now with college being so expensive now, that's the smartest move to do, is go into the military and let the military pay for your school. Just go in there for 2 years, see if you like it. If you don't like it, get out and take advantage, because there's still some military bases that they offer a lot of these college classes. And you can go to college while you're in the military and you don't pay nothing for it. So it's a benefit to everybody to go into the military, because the education is there and you get to see and travel, see different countries, different cultures, and great to meet a lot of other people. Like right now, I belong to Chapter 106 out of Denton, Texas. I'm the Junior Vice Commander. Our organization, what it does, it helps out all veterans that are in Denton County itself. But as myself being a certified officer, I'm able to do all claims for all veterans in all 50 states, which is a plus. And every time I encounter one veteran, I ask him, how is he doing? Has he filed a claim? There's a lot of veterans in another world that they qualify for claims, so I got them in the right direction and do a claim for them.
Combat?
Not actually combat. It's just patrols at the DMZ in Camp Libertyville. As for myself, back in those days, you had a lot of drill sergeants that were mean, used to get beat up. Nowadays, you can't even put your hand on the soldier now, because now they want to court-martial you. But being back in those days during the Vietnam War, it was rough, because they were trying to get you ready to go to war and expect the unexpected. I would say if you're Hispanic, if you come from a broken family or a non-broken family, it could, depending on the situation you're in, I urge every Hispanic to go into the military for at least a couple of years, try it. And then if you decide to have a family, you'll benefit from the military. There's a lot of Hispanics in the military as we speak. My family, they're all great. My message to them, I say that I thank them for being there for me all the time in the military. I thank them for sending me goodie boxes when I was overseas that you couldn't get over there. Every little thing helped when you got something through the mail, especially Mexican food, which they didn't have over there. So you get a little stuff, and they always supported me in every way, and that's what I thank them for. My MOS was 11 Charlie, which is the motors. I dealt with both types of motors. I dealt with the 81 and the 4 Deuce. The difference between 81 and 4 Deuce, the 81, you carried it everywhere you went with it. And the 4 Deuce, you had an APC where you would fire from the APC, which is a armored personnel carrier. because you couldn't carry the four dudes, because the base plate itself weighs 250 pounds, and the two weighs 150 pounds. So those are two differences between those motors.
I'm from South Texas, McAllen. I serve in Fort Jackson, South Carolina. Well, there were more jobs over here in Denton. See, I come from West Texas, too, you know. Haskell, Texas. That's where I was raised. I got married there. And then we came all the way to Frisco, Texas. There were jobs. And from there, we moved here to Denton. Well, I guess we had to talk to him real easy, you know. Tell me, you know, what it is about it, you know. I got my son into it, too. He joined the Army. And he's about 52 years old. But he joined the Army. And he was in the service. Yeah, he served about 2 years and a half. And then he came home. I helped, you know, for them to go to school, get an education, you know, when they go into service, they come back home and go to college or do something, you know, and so they can get better jobs. I grow up, it's kind of, you know, running around, you know, with a whole bunch of kiddos, you know, in the neighborhood, you know, and I wasn't doing too good, you know. But I went to school and everything, and helped me. You know. I already know how to tell them, you know. Because you tell them, and they come with something else, you know. They need spanking. You know, when I was growing up in school, our principal used to have a big pedal, and if we don't mind, he'll get with the pedal. Then it used to be like now. If you spank you were baby, whatever, you know, they call the police. Back then, that's why we came up to be good people, you know. I'm proud of my dad, you know. See. They need to go to school, get an education, and so they can have a good job. Well, I got them good, you know, on that. My grandsons, they come up to be a good kids, you know. So I got them straightened out. And I told them, if you guys need some money, you have to go to work and keep money in the pocket, go to work. And I asked them now, I said, As you got money in your pockets, yes, Grandpa, it'll work. So, okay. Well, I was drafted, you know, in 67. And I went to, I didn't go anywhere, you know, because I had to go to the doctor, you know, because my wife was having a baby. And I had to tell them that I couldn't assert. But I had to go to the doctor and I had to get a form. So I did. That's how I come out in. Back then, you know, they were drafting because of the Vietnam War. It was the original draft. Yes, ma'am. I was going to own the shop. But then later in 74, I was trying to teach my kids, you know, that they need to go to serve in the Army, do some Navy, whatever. And the only one that listened to me was my oldest son. He joined the Army. The middle one, he said, I ain't gonna do that. I'm not stupid. So I said, it's not being stupid, it's being smart, but he didn't do it. His doing prosthetics. He went to get his license permit, you know, in Austin. I don't know if he passed that test or not, you know. He's supposed to call me and let me know. But he's doing pretty good. Oh, he got killed. He was getting married in May of 88. And he didn't make it. They used to go to that, spring break in the valley. They were going their way, and they had a wreck back here. I don't think I did that. No, sir. I tried to get people, you know, to join, you know. But they won't do it, you know. I don't know why, you know. Because it's our duty, you know, to... You're an American. You're supposed to defend your country and serve. So I'm proud that I served, you know, later, but I did. Well, I joined the Vietnam Veterans of America. I'm a member, and I'm a member of DAB. I'm a member of American Legion, and I'm doing pretty good. And I'm proud. I guess if I would do that, I don't know what I would have done, you know.
I was born in a little town in South Texas, Robstown, Texas. The Anglos call it Robstown, we call it Robstan. That's my hometown. I served in Korea from 54 to 57. I was 18 years old when I joined. Well, for one thing, it gave me a lot of self-confidence. The 3 years that I was there, I was 18, scared, timid, shy, and I overcome all that. Well, I found out that there's no country like the U.S. After being in Korea for a year and a half, it's a big difference. Of course, we know it's a third world country, but their politics, the way they treat people and all that, nothing like the good USA. I would have to say people skill, how to get along with folks. Even though when you get there, you think that they're all bad people, and it's not so. They're very, very, very good, very nice people, very courteous, a lot of respect. They respect the elderly like no other that I have experienced before. When they meet an elderly person on the street, they stop and bow. It's a sign of respect. Where do you see that? No, I was very lucky. When I got to Korea, a few months, the war had already ended when I got there. And 6 months after I was there, they signed up a peace treaty. We would still carry weapons all over and all that, but I was very lucky that I didn't get to see combat. Even though we carry rifles and everywhere we would go, we have to be cautious, because you'll still hear gunfire here and there, but not in the front lines. Well, the advice I give to young people, especially young people that do not know where they're going, they have no goals in school and do whatever, I always encourage them to join the military, because the military will shake you up and give you a good focus on what you really want to do. I don't advise this to anybody, just those people that don't know what they want to do. They quit school and don't know what they want to do. So the service, it's a good example for them. No, I was 18 years old. Oh. I was smart. It was so beautiful. I remember looking at a service station that we take for granted here, and just admired how beautiful it was. Because over there, a service station was a 55-gallon drum with gas. That was the service station. And it was just beautiful. Great experience.
So?
Well, like I said, I learned via how respectful they were to one another. So I brought that with me from Korea, to always respect people, no matter who they are, no matter what they do. Always respect them for what they are. And that helped me a lot to get along with people and to be a better husband, a better father, a better friend. Well, the first thing I would tell them to stay in school. For God's sake, stay in school. Don't do like I did. I'm a high school dropout, or kick out. I was kicked out of school. So I encourage these young people, no matter what, stay in school. Get an education. That's my only regret, that I didn't have an education. And that will help them through life to make better decisions and be better citizens. Well, we've been here 50 years, and my profession is barber, so a barber for about 40-something years. And at the same time, I was involved with the city, and I was involved with the church, with both communities. They're different communities. And I would help people, like back then, they started having a problem with what they call illegal aliens, and they were just pick them up for any little thing and put them in jail, and I would go and speak for them. I was a voice for those people that could not speak English, which I don't speak English very well, but I can get across. And like I said, besides church, I was involved with the city, which are different communities. And I would try to help people, because most of them didn't speak English, to help them with translations here and there. I would get calls from the hospital, from the city jail, from work sites, everywhere. And since I was cutting hair, I could set up my appointments where I could go and do some translations at wherever they were needed. And I did a lot of that, both Lupe and I, you know, not just me, both of us. School board, just put up the name, and of course they didn't say right away, yeah, we'll do it. They had to, you know how it is, negotiate and this and that, and some people said that in order to name a school after somebody, they had to be dead. And I hear there were several volunteers that were ready to do away with it so they could name it. And that's just the way it happened. A great honor. Well, it was very different that when the media got back from Saudi. At those times, you would take a bus from, for example, mine was from San Antonio to Robstown, and there was nobody there to cheer you or know anything. The bus stops at the bus station. We was about 10 blocks from my house, put my duffel bag on my shoulder, and walked through the neighborhood to my house. And I didn't knock. Back then, we didn't have to lock the doors. I always liked to surprise them. I would walk in, and there was my grandmother and my mom and my sisters, and I'm here. It was just a great, great, great feeling to be back home.
And what the first
thing I wanted was tortillas and frijoles, because I haven't had those for a year and a half. It was really nice. Basic training. Well, I was 18 years old. I played football in high school, so I was in great shape. Basic training was nothing to me. It was just like football practice. A lot of people had rough time. They would get tired and get hurt and all this and all that. And for me, it was kind of fun. Crawling under the barbed wires and all that. It was nothing, because I was in great shape, thanks to football.
I was born in Eagle Pass, Texas, but I'm from San Antonio. That's my hometown. Even after being here for 50 years, I still feel San Antonio my hometown. And I went to training in San Diego, California. And then I was stationed on a base in, right outside of Long Beach, California, a naval base named Seal Beach. I was basically grew up during the war, and everything around me at that time had to do with World War II and all the movies, all the stories, newspapers, everything. So I just felt that I had to take part in it. 17. Number one, San Antonio's always been an army town, and there were always 300,000 or 400,000 soldiers. So everywhere you went was full of soldiers in khaki uniforms. And I grew up in the street downtown San Antonio, very close. And everybody on that street went into the Navy. And there were a couple of guys who went into the Marine Corps, but no one went into the Army or the Air Force, or a lot of Air Force people. You had to be in the Navy, and everybody was. And I felt like I had no choice but to go into the Navy. So during the war was ending when I got into the Navy. And they were changing over from the wartime Navy to the peacetime Navy. And the people that had been in the war during the Navy, in the Navy during the war, were all getting discharged. And the Navy was trying to build up its forces for the peacetime. And one of the things they did is they gave you a chance to stay in the Navy. They really tried to get you to stay in, because everybody wanted to get out. They gave a series of tests, and they said if you pass these three tests with a very high score, you could go and do anything you want to in the Navy, whatever you want. If you make high scores on two, then you can have a choice. And if you make a good grade on one, you just have a choice again, but not as good. Then I liked that. I liked the Navy when I got in. I took the three tests and I made very high scores. They had a long interview with a very young officer who was on the way out himself, and I told him that I would be interested in staying in the Navy. This is what they were interested in. I had already taken the test. I had already passed the scores that they wanted, the numbers that they wanted. I wanted to be on a battleship. And that was my number one choice. And they said, well, that's only a short assignment. What do you want to do for a career? And I said, I certainly want to be an officer, and I would like to be a pilot. And they said, well, you didn't go to college, so you can't be an officer and you can't be a pilot. I said, well, he didn't say anything about that. I said, well, I would like to be on a large ship so that I can do a lot of traveling. I said, well, we have use for you elsewhere in Long Beach, which is right part of California. And I tried to talk my way out of it, and they wouldn't listen to me. They had told me that I could have my choice, and now they're cutting that down. So I said, well, I want to be on a ship. So they put me on a tugboat, and that was kind of like an insult, and I got out. I would have stayed in, but I liked it. I liked it very much, but I didn't want to be in to be a carpenter or a machinist or something like that. I really wanted to be a pilot. I wanted to learn how to fly. I finally made it, but I made it here in San Antonio when I was 40 years old. I'm retired from North Texas. I have came to Denton in 1965 to work at North Texas. I was on the faculty at North Texas for 35 years, and I was a professor of microbiology, which has nothing to do with the Navy. The Navy was part of my growing up, actually. When I went in, I was 17 years old. When I came out, I was still 18. So it was just part of my, the things that you learn when you've grown up. Later on, you had to forget half of that. Things were going in the wrong direction and what have you. And, I learned how to deal with people, how to talk with people. I think I learned something of independence in the Navy, of taking care of yourself and doing things for yourself, and not depending on other people to do things for you. I have always followed that. If I want to do something, I do it myself. I think if you look at the American citizen or a citizen of any country, you've got a spectrum. You've got people who serve their country tremendously well at one end, and you've got people who kind of do for themselves and not very much. Other people have to take care of them at the other end. So it's kind of a line that goes like this. And I think it's our duty to try to be as high up on that line as possible. Get an education, work. Contribute more to your country when you have some knowledge, when you contribute to the well-being of the country. And we're always called to pay taxes. If you put in, you pay taxes, you're putting money in, or wealth, or whatever you're putting in. If you, on the other hand, are taking out, then you're not doing as well as when you're putting in. Try to stay to a place where you can take care of yourself. Your work is what gets you where you want to go, rather than somebody giving it to you. And I think we can all do that if we try. Hard work. Planning and know what you're doing. Don't let the thing carry you. You carry it. Don't go along because it's easy. It's easier to just float along and not worry too much about what you're doing. It's harder to try to do something on your own. Try to do it by yourself. Sometimes you have to go against the current sometimes, and it requires a lot more effort. I think you get a lot more satisfaction out of that than to just pick up whatever somebody wants to give you. In other words, make your own life, make your own way. And I think it can be done. I think that everybody understands that fairly easily. In this country, it's very easy to not have to do very much to get by. The schools are free, it's easy to go to school and get a job that somebody's going to help you. It's harder if you want to do things over and above what you can get for nothing. In other countries, when nobody gives you anything, you have to fight for everything you can. And the competition is very hard. In this country, the competition is very easy and life is very easy. reasons I wanted to stay in the neighborhood was to travel. Well, I didn't get to do that, so I did a little bit of traveling. When I went to school and went to work, and I got to see other countries as well. And life is very hard in some of those places, and very hard to make it, even if you have talent and ability. It's a lot harder than here. So I'm afraid that we are taking advantage of that, and we're losing our edge as a country. Too many people depending on somebody to do something for them. Give me a job, give me a promotion, give me a better pay, without saying, I'm going to take a job, I'm going to take a promotion. You can do that without being offensive, without being selfish. Just apply yourself. One of the things that we don't like is politicians, because politicians have a tendency to take advantage, and they're getting worse and worse. The politicians don't come to easy what they can get for nothing. And they make all the rules and all the laws that enrich them, that are in their favor, not in the favor of the country. And it's a shame to see that. We've got a beautiful country, a wonderful country, but we're losing it.
Originally, I'm from West Texas, from Haskell. It's a little town between here and Lubbock, about 3,000 population. And after the war, we moved to Denton, and I've been living here since. Okay, I joined straight from school. I joined the Marine Corps and went to San Diego. They said if you go to San Diego, you would be a Hollywood Marine, so I wanted to go there. I went there. And then from there, I came home for 20 days, and after the 20 days were up, we were straight for another part of the training, and I never made it back home again. I just went straight to Vietnam from there. And when I arrived in Vietnam, we arrived in Da Nang via Delta Airlines. We spent one afternoon in Da Nang, and then from there they flew us on a C-130 to Phu Bai, another place there close by. And in Phu Bai, that's when we got all the shots, like 40 of them. And all at the same time too, no resting, no nothing. And then they had the nerve to tell us, y'all, we could go to the NCO club. We were able, nobody could walk. And from Phu Bai, they loaded us, they gave us our final destinations, our units, and we flew on a Marine helicopter, Chinook, the double-bladed one, and they landed us right there on the runway at Khe San. And I didn't know, I thought Khe San was a village. I didn't even know it was a combat base. And then as time started going by, I learned the situation in Khe San was gonna get worse. And I said to myself, how did I get into this? And it really did. At first, when I arrived in Khe San, there was a hardly anything going on, a few skirmishes here and there, but and then by Christmas, Kaysan was already surrounded, and we were 6,000 Marines entrenched in Kaysan, and the enemy force was estimated at 40,000 around us. And we started getting battered day and night, and it's not funny, but out of the 6,000 total, the total count of 6,000 Marines, only 256 died there in Kaysan, but countless wounded, including me. And it started getting, every day as it went by, it was starting to get worse and worse and worse, and then came word that Kaysan was not gonna fall, that we had to hold Kaysan at all costs to the last man living. And that was orders from President Johnson then. And I said, oh, I guess I'll write my wife a letter and tell her to keep her eyes on if Kaysan fell, that means I wasn't coming home. But she watched the news all the time. It was like a 3-day delay thing back then. There was no camcorders and all that. So when the siege started, it lasted 77 days. I was only there about 10 days of the siege before I got hit. And what kept us alive and going this long was not only the powerful 6,000 Marines inside the base, but the powerful B-52 bombers and all the bombs that they dropped around Kaysan, that they said, history says that the back of the enemy was broken, and out of the 40,000, about estimated 15 to 20,000 died. Out of the other 20,000, half of them deserted, and the other half were never found. Well, I can imagine 750-pound bombs falling on top of you. That's not gonna live very much. And but I was fortunate that I was wounded on January the 28th, 1968, and immediately the medevacs came, and they couldn't get down to pick the wounded and the dead because they were getting shot at everywhere that they landed. The enemy had, the North Vietnamese had every inch of Kaysan pinpointed for their mortars and rockets. If they saw you standing there, they could hit you with a mortar right there. It was all crawling in the trench, and they called it the Kaysan shuffle. When I was wounded, I went back the same way, almost. I went to Phu Bai, to Da Nang, and then from there they sent my group to Cameron Base, the area in Vietnam where it's beautiful beach, you know, and beaches and R&R for some of the veterans. But the minute we got there, they started hitting Cameron Bay too, and so there was nothing we could do but just wait. And they started medevacking everybody out. And then I woke up one morning. I was in the Philippine, Okinawa. And I was fortunate to see General Westmoreland's wife came and visited us. Well, actually, she came with a card, and she was asking every individual, "Do you want to be here?" And everybody was getting two. And one guy next to me, he was hurting also, but he wasn't hurting that bad that he couldn't drink a beer. So I told Miss Westmoreland that I really didn't drink, and I really didn't want to start there because I went to get home someday. And the guy next to me, he kept on waving at me and saying, no, take him. Well, that guy drank 4 beers in 15 minutes, and he was asleep. And then from there, they flew us to Hawaii, and in Hawaii is where they take you. I didn't know that, but they take you with blue ribbons, red, orange. I don't know what all the others meant, but I asked one of the corpsmen. I said, "What is a blue ribbon mean?" And he said, "That means you got a $1 million wound. You're going home." Then I could go to sleep. And they finally flew us out on a 747 from Honolulu. We landed in San Francisco one day. The next morning, they flew us to San Antonio, where they did most of the major work in the hospital on my leg. And from there, they flew us to the Naval Hospital in Corpus Christi. And that's where I spent more time there than I did in Vietnam, actually 11 months in the hospital. Well, you know, most of the time, where I came from, high school, where I came from, the weather was hot. We used to shop in the cotton fields and prayed for a little cloud to come by with rain so we could go home, but it never happened. And I always kind of used to the heat, but when we got over there, it was a different kind of heat, because in the shade, it was 125 degrees hot. And then the monsoons came, and it would rain day and night. You had to splash the water out of your sea ration can so you could eat your food, and it didn't matter what you drank. It was going to be water anyway by the time you finished drinking it. And then you had to put up with rats everywhere. There were rats. That's another. And if they bit you, you'd love them to die. And then the leeches. There were real tiny little worms or something like that, and they start sucking your blood. They get as big as that. They just stress with all your blood. And you couldn't take them off, because if you try to take them off, the tentacle would stay in there and it would get infected. The only way you could was burning them with a cigarette or insect repellent, they'd fall right out. You could almost hear the come undone. But they would. You didn't realize you had a leech on, especially when you cross the water, the rivers. And only after a while, when you feel that burning sensation on your, and then you look, and you're begging somebody to get the repellent out to get them off. And there were ways to keep the leeches out. You would blouse your fatigues, you would blouse them, and I would push them inside my boot and tie the boot real, real tight, and then the rest of the leg, I would flip it over the boot and tie that one too. Kept them from going in your body. But the thing about it, that when you cross the river or a stream or anything that had to do with water, even in the jungle, you were gonna get, you had to check yourself immediately, and because you were gonna have at least two or three of them, the leeches, and they were just as gross as the war, I guess, But other than that, you had to fight mosquitoes, the rats, the leeches, and the enemy. And sometimes your own commanders. But, yes.
Yes, I have my Uncle Louis that served in the Korean War, and I have my Grandpa Ralph that served in the Vietnam War. It's probably the Vietnam Memorial because it's just this long black wall full of names on it, and it kind of recognizes how we take for granted for what they do when they go out there and they never come back. It's kind of sad that we don't really recognize them for that as we should. At the Arlington Cemetery, because I got to lay the wreath on an unknown soldier, and it was a real honor because it's just the feeling of it. It's really cool and exciting. And then when you look down, you get to see all these hundreds of thousands of headstones. Well, there's a woman named Miss Stacy, and she had a basket that, like, you, there was names, and if you had to put your name on in the basket, and then she drawed one of a person, and it was four people that were chosen. And so if someone was chosen, she would give the basket to them. And then if they chose someone, they had to give the basket to the other person, so it would be fair. And so I was just one of them. No, they're all from Denton ISD. Last year in March, yes, it was like 9 degrees out there, and then we had to wear this like white button-down long-sleeve shirt. And it was like really cold. We had to take off our coats too. He's really stern. He never really moves, and he won't talk unless like it's for the wreath. So like there's like this facility downstairs where they prepare for ceremonies, and that's where you talk to them. You can talk to them there.
And so
I think they take shifts, but I don't know that exact answer. Well, might need to pack a coat. And it's probably, you're gonna have a fun time, and it's really cool. It's a cool experience. Well, we saw the Iwo Jima monument, and if you go around the circle, the flag raises up. You can see like, it's like an illusion, the flag raises up. And then we went to the Washington Mall and got to see where Abraham Lincoln was assassinated, the Forest Theater. And then we went to the Washington Cathedral, and that thing is huge.
So what
happened? It makes me feel like I know more about the world and just a better person, kind of thing.
So
well, we have rights, and I'm glad we're not slaves because we earned that freedom from Britain, and like, American, I think, is just better because we get more rights than other countries will.
And what would you say to people that might be interested in serving our country in the military? You have quite a few family members that are veterans, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
What would you say to
them? Well, if you want to serve, maybe you just go where you want to go, just whatever floats your boat. No, but I think my cousin Samuel Madrid is, and maybe. Kind of a little, because it's just, I don't know how to say it, it's just, I have a lot of family members that served, and it kind of made me more want to go to serve because they kind of inspired me a little bit.